messages from the movement.
Hallelujah.
We thank God that for over 200 years, our Zion, the African Methodist Episcopal Church, that was not created for polity or doctrinal reasons, but for the purposes of setting all captives free, not just spiritual, but physical. So we come into this house gathering God's name to worship Him, and we shall do so by lifting up our doxology. Now, it's a bit of a remix, amen? But the words are still the same, amen? So put your glad hands together.
You're my rock. You're my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Just want to reiterate the Luke account. Beginning with verse 25, says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, What is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So he answered and said, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Then Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a certain priest came down that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you." So which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, "He who showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Amen.
Amen.
Just for a few moments, I just want to preach from the thought, is there a neighbor in the house? Is there a neighbor in the house? When I was growing up in North Carolina, my mother would send me to the neighbor's house to borrow a cup of sugar. The neighbor was Cousin Jane, who lived adjacent to our house across the road. Anyone who lived within the neighborhood was considered a part of our small community, but only those who lived next door to each other or within close proximity to one another's homes were considered neighbors. In this text, Jesus gives a new meaning to the word neighbor. He identifies neighbor as one who shows mercy, compassion, understanding, forgiveness, clemency, and the list could go on. This text also lets us see that a neighbor can be anyone who demonstrates these qualities. It is these qualities or traits that make someone a neighbor. One of the leading insurance companies in the United States has a slogan which says, "Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there," which implies that this is more than a slogan. Chairman Edward B. Rust Jr. of the leadership team of State Farm gives their definition of good neighbor: someone to be trusted, a courteous, friendly source of help when help is needed, someone you can count on, someone who cares. When we take a close look at the text, it says in verse 30, "Then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead." A certain man implies that there was something different about this man. Perhaps someone of a different ethnic persuasion. Nevertheless, we know that he was a human being. When any kind of injustice is leveled, it has a way of erasing the lines of racial divide. Lines are crossed all the time when it comes to the color of one's skin. A certain man, Mike Brown, Stephon Clark, Eric Garner, Philando Castile, Freddie Gray, a certain woman, Sarah Blaine, 65-year-old Rose Campbell, and the countless black and brown boys, black and brown girls like 12-year-old Jameer Rice, black and brown men, black and brown women who are distinguished by the color of their skin. A certain man went from Jerusalem to Jericho, known as a bloody way because many had been overtaken by robbers or thieves who traveled that way. One's life was at risk to go that way. For the African American, a brown boy, a man, girl, a woman to leave home and go into the public square is to go the bloody way. You just don't know if you will return home or not. Just don't know what awaits you outside of the doors of your home. When my grown sons leave home, I'm constantly texting and calling them and asking them, where are you? Did you make it home yet?
Yeah.
When my middle son was in college in Mississippi, attending Alcorn State University, a historic HBCU, one Friday he was riding with two of his friends in their car who were exchange students from Russia, and they being white and he being black, and he was sitting in the back seat and they were in the front. The young man driving made an illegal U-turn and the police saw it and pulled him over. The policeman walked up to the car and asked for his license, and as he asked for it, he looked in the back, and when he saw my son, he told him to get out of the car. His two friends questioned the police, why are you telling him to get out of the car? He didn't do anything. The police told them to shut up and make my son get out of the car, slammed him on the ground, handcuffed him, and took him to jail. I was sitting in the quiet of my home when I received the call from my son. He could only make one call, and he called me here in Pennsylvania. And praise God, there's more to the story, and this story has a positive outcome, thank God. Thank God for the neighbors who came to the aid of my son. When he left campus with his friends that day, he didn't know he would end up in jail before the day was over. But thank God he's alive today. Hallelujah. The text says that this certain man fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. They stripped him and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. Little did our forefathers and foremothers know the rippling effect of falling among the thieves and robbers who invaded our motherland, taking them from their homeland, bringing them by slave ships to this country, packed in like sardines in a can. Many died, too many to count. For those who survived, little did they know that the grave rippling effects of that trip to America in 1619, and now 399 years later, you fill in the blank. Our ancestors were stripped of all that they had, stripped of their homeland, stripped of their families, stripped of their heritage, stripped of their resources, stripped of their human rights, stripped of their names, stripped of their economic status, stripped of their customs, stripped of their religion, stripped of their wherewithal to be a man, stripped of their wherewithal to be a woman. They were stripped and beaten. The most brutal, barbaric, cruel, debased, hideous, inhumane, insane, vicious, violent treatment of a human being ever. That it has left a root so deeply entrenched in the foundation of the United States of America that extends to this present day. It is witnessed by the blatant racism unleashed against us as a people right now, and the response of the oppressed that is seen as horrific. No regard for the actions of the oppressor that precipitated the response. How can we live in a nation that has little regard for life? Is it safe for anyone? What will become of this nation? The text says the man was stripped and beaten. Beaten, a type of horrible infliction of a wound that not only lands on the physical body but deeply wounds the spirit of a person. Our foreparents were beaten so that their will could be broken. They were tortured in every dimension of their very souls, stripped and beaten, brainwashed, told you can't learn, you have no history, you have no heritage, Africa is nothing but jungle, you're barbaric, uncivilized, black is bad, it's ugly, and it goes on and on. And every idea that they came up with was taken, or if their name was attached to it, very few benefited economically from the invention or the idea. Every privilege earned was on the backs of our foreparents. White privilege is nothing to brag about. All it speaks to is that one is a recipient of benefits reaped from an unjust.
Thank you.
Mold me, make me after your will. While I am standing, yielded and still and bold. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. For truly, God, you're my rock. You're my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Just want to reiterate the Luke account. Begin with verse 25. It says, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor?
Yeah.
Then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. So which of these 3 do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, he who showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Amen.
Amen.
Just for a few moments, I just want to preach from the thought, is there a neighbor in the house? Is there a neighbor in the house? When I was growing up in North Carolina, my mother would send me to the neighbor's house to borrow a cup of sugar. The neighbor was Cousin Jane, who lived adjacent to our house across the road. Anyone who lived within the neighborhood was considered a part of our small community, but only those who lived next door to each other or within close proximity to one another's homes were considered neighbors. In this text, Jesus gives a new meaning to the word neighbor. He identifies neighbor as one who shows mercy, compassion, understanding, forgiveness, clemency, and the list could go on. This text also lets us see that a neighbor can be anyone who demonstrates these qualities. It is these qualities or traits that make someone a neighbor. One of the leading insurance companies in the United States has a slogan which says, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there, which implies that this is more than a slogan. Chairman Edward B. Rust Jr. of the leadership team of State Farm gives their definition of good neighbor. Someone to be trusted, a courteous, friendly source of help when help is needed. Someone you can count on, someone who cares. When we take a close look at the text, it says in verse 30, Then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. A certain man implies that there was something different about this man. Perhaps someone of a different ethnic persuasion. Nevertheless, we know that he was a human being. When any kind of injustice is leveled, it has a way of erasing the lines of racial divide. Lines are crossed all the time when it comes to the color of one's skin. A certain man, Mike Brown, Stephon Clark, Eric Garner, Philando Castile, Freddie Gray, a certain woman, Sarah Blaine, 65-year-old Rose Campbell, and the countless black and brown boys, black and brown girls like 12-year-old Jameer Rice, black and brown men, black and brown women who are distinguished by the color of their skin. A certain man went from Jerusalem to Jericho, known as a bloody way because many had been overtaken by robbers or thieves who traveled that way. One's life was at risk to go that way. For the African American, a brown boy, a man, girl, a woman to leave home and go into the public square is to go the bloody way. You just don't know if you will return home or not. Just don't know what awaits you outside of the doors of your home. When my grown sons leave home, I'm constantly texting and calling them and asking them, where are you? Did you make it home yet? When my middle son was in college in Mississippi, attending Alcorn State University, a historic HBCU, one Friday he was riding with two of his friends in their car who were exchange students from Russia, and they being white and he being black, and he was sitting in the back seat and they were in the front. The young man driving made an illegal U-turn, and the police saw it and pulled him over. The policeman walked up to the car and asked for his license. And as he asked for it, he looked in the back. And when he saw my son, he told him to get out of the car. His two friends questioned the police, why are you telling him to get out of the car? He didn't do anything. The police told them to shut up and make my son get out of the car. Slammed him on the ground, handcuffed him, and took him to jail. I was sitting in the quiet of my home when I received the call from my son. He could only make one call, and he called me here in Pennsylvania. And praise God, there's more to the story, and this story has a positive outcome, thank God. Thank God for the neighbors who came to the aid of my son. When he left campus with his friends that day, he didn't know he would end up in jail before the day was over. But thank God he's alive today. Hallelujah. The text says that this certain man fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. They stripped him and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. Little did our forefathers and foremothers know the rippling effect of falling among the thieves and robbers who invaded our motherland, taking them from their homeland, bringing them by slave ships to this country, packed in like sardines in a can. Many died, too many to count. For those who survived, little did they know that the grave rippling effects of that trip to America in 1619, and now 399 years later, you fill in the blank. Our ancestors were stripped of all that they had, stripped of their homeland, stripped of their families, stripped of their heritage, stripped of their resources, stripped of their human rights, stripped of their names, stripped of their economic status, stripped of their customs, stripped of their religion, stripped of their wherewithal to be a man, stripped of their wherewithal to be a woman. They were stripped and beaten. The most brutal, barbaric, cruel, debased, hideous, inhumane, insane, vicious, violent, violent treatment of a human being ever, that it has left a root so deeply entrenched in the foundation of the United States of America that extends to this present day. It is witnessed by the blatant racism unleashed against us as a people right now, and the response of the oppressed that is seen as horrific with no regard for the actions of the oppressor that precipitated the response. How can we live in a nation that has little regard for life? Is it safe for anyone? What will become of this nation? The text says the man was stripped and beaten. A type of horrible infliction of a wound that not only lands on the physical body but deeply wounds the spirit of a person. Our foreparents were beaten so that their will could be broken. They were tortured in every dimension of their very souls. Stripped and beaten, brainwashed, told you can't learn. You have no history. You have no heritage. Africa is nothing but jungle. You're barbaric, uncivilized. Black is bad. It's ugly. And it goes on and on. And every idea that they came up with was taken, or if their name was attached to it, very few benefited economically from the invention or the idea. Every privilege earned was on the backs of our foreparents. White privilege is nothing to brag about. All it speaks to is that one is a recipient of benefits reaped from an unjust. Mold me, make me after your will, while I am standing yielded and still and bold. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. For truly, God, you're my rock. You're my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Just want to reiterate the Luke account. Beginning with verse 25, says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, What is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So he answered and said, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Then Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, When I come again, I will repay you. So which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, he who showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Amen.
Amen.
Just for a few moments, I just want to preach from the thought, is there a neighbor in the house? Is there a neighbor in the house? When I was growing up in North Carolina, my mother would send me to the neighbor's house to borrow a cup of sugar. The neighbor was Cousin Jane, who lived adjacent to our house across the road. Anyone who lived within the neighborhood was considered a part of our small community, but only those who lived next door to each other or within close proximity to one another's homes were considered neighbors. In this text, Jesus gives a new meaning to the word neighbor. He identifies neighbor as one who shows mercy, compassion, understanding, forgiveness, clemency, and the list could go on. This text also lets us see that a neighbor can be anyone who demonstrates these qualities. It is these qualities or traits that make someone a neighbor. One of the leading insurance companies in the United States has a slogan which says, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Which implies that this is more than a slogan. Chairman Edward B. Rust Jr. of the leadership team of State Farm gives their definition of good neighbor. Someone to be trusted, a courteous, friendly source of help when help is needed. Someone you can count on, someone who cares. When we take a close look at the text, it says in verse 30, then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. A certain man implies that there was something different about this man. Perhaps someone of a different ethnic persuasion. Nevertheless, we know that he was a human being. When any kind of injustice is leveled, it has a way of erasing the lines of racial divide. Lines are crossed all the time when it comes to the color of one's skin. A certain man, Mike Brown, Stephon Clark, Eric Garner, Philando Castile, Freddie Gray, a certain woman, Sarah Blaine, 65-year-old Rose Campbell, and the countless black and brown boys, black and brown girls like 12-year-old Jameer Rice, black and brown men, black and brown women who are distinguished by the color of their skin. A certain man went from Jerusalem to Jericho, known as a bloody way because many had been overtaken by robbers or thieves who traveled that way. One's life was at risk to go that way. For the African American, a brown boy, a man, girl, a woman to leave home and go into the public square is to go the bloody way. You just don't know if you will return home or not. Just don't know what awaits you outside of the doors of your home. When my grown sons leave home, I'm constantly texting and calling them and asking them, where are you? Did you make it home yet? When my middle son was in college in Mississippi, attending Alcorn State University, a historic HBCU, one Friday he was riding with two of his friends in their car who were exchange students from Russia, and they being white and he being black, and he was sitting in the back seat and they were in the front. The young man driving made an illegal U-turn, and the police saw it and pulled him over. The policeman walked up to the car and asked for his license. And as he asked for it, he looked in the back. And when he saw my son, he told him to get out of the car. His two friends questioned the police, why are you telling him to get out of the car? He didn't do anything. The police told them to shut up and make my son get out of the car. Slammed him on the ground, handcuffed him, and took him to jail. I was sitting in the quiet of my home when I received the call from my son. He could only make one call, and he called me here in Pennsylvania. And praise God, there's more to the story, and this story has a positive outcome, thank God. Thank God, thank God for the neighbors who came to the aid of my son. When he left campus with his friends that day, he didn't know he would end up in jail before the day was over. But thank God he's alive today. Hallelujah. The text says that this certain man fell among thieves who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. They stripped him and beat him and went off, leaving him half dead. Little did our forefathers and foremothers know the rippling effect of falling among the thieves and robbers who invaded our motherland, taking them from their homeland, bringing them by slave ships to this country, packed in like sardines in a can. Many died, too many to count. For those who survived, little did they know that the grave rippling effects of that trip to America in 1619, and now 399 years later, you fill in the blank. Our ancestors were stripped of all that they had, stripped of their homeland, stripped of their families, stripped of their heritage, stripped of their resources, stripped of their human rights, stripped of their names, stripped of their economic status, stripped of their customs, stripped of their religion, stripped of their wherewithal to be a man, stripped of their wherewithal to be a woman. They were stripped and beaten. The most brutal, barbaric, cruel, debased, hideous, inhumane, insane, vicious, violent treatment of a human being ever, that it has left a root so deeply entrenched in the foundation of the United States of America that extends to this present day. It is witnessed by the blatant racism unleashed against us as a people right now, and the response of the oppressed that is seen as horrific with no regard for the actions of the oppressor that precipitated the response. How can we live in a nation that has little regard for life? Is it safe for anyone? What will become of this nation? The text says the man was stripped and beaten. Beaten, a type of horrible infliction of a wound that not only lands on the physical body, but deeply wounds the spirit of a person. Our foreparents were beaten so that their will could be broken. They were tortured in every dimension of their very souls, stripped and beaten, brainwashed, told you can't learn, you have no history, you have no heritage, Africa is nothing but jungle, you're barbaric, uncivilized, black is bad, it's ugly, and it goes on and on. And every idea that they came up with was taken, or if their name was attached to it, very few benefited economically from the invention or the idea. Every privilege earned was on the backs of our foreparents. White privilege is nothing to brag about. All it speaks to is that one is a recipient of benefits reaped from an So when our black and brown sons and men are being watched from the police car, they're being sized up to meet a demand for free or for pennies later on in the concrete plantation called prison. And when the United States companies pull their labor from third world countries, where do you think they put their businesses? That's why black and brown men serve unfair sentences for crime that should only get them a probationary sentence. Left by the side of the road, half dead. And to you, like God has given it to me. Because where social justice prevails, these kinds of explanations pale in comparison to the value of a human life. We're talking about a life here. A human life. He was passed over by those who figured that helping him would jeopardize their well-being. Helping him would be an inconvenience. Helping him would go against the ceremonial law. Helping him, praise God, would violate their customs. Who would help this man? How many people keep going or keep looking the other way because they don't want to get it? might mess up my image. It might cause me my job. It might mean I'm seen in a different light by my peers. They might call me an in-lover.
Yeah, yeah.
I may refuse to get involved even though they know that the injustices leveled against black and brown people are not warranted. Are injustices against anyone ever warranted?
Amen.
What about you? Will you ever rise to the high status of being called a neighbor according to Almighty God's definition?
Amen.
Will you ever meet the criteria
yeah.
to be called one?
Yeah. Amen.
Who would help this man left beside the road
yeah.
half dead?
Yeah.
The word of God says that a certain man came along,
yeah.
a certain Samaritan, perhaps other Samaritans had passed him by, but this one stopped.
This one stopped.
And when he saw the man, he came to where he was and had compassion on him. The compassion he felt compelled, it compelled him to do something about the man's situation. The man showed himself to be a neighbor to someone he did not know, to someone he'd never seen before. And this neighborly act of mercy had to restore hope within the heart of this poor beaten up man as he was picked up and lifted up, praise God.
Amen.
In the same way it was that man called Jesus who saw our ancestors left beside the road of life, marginalized, disenfranchised, and not come see about it. I'm always amazed at the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The same religion that was used to beat our ancestors into a civilized submission and enslaved, praise God, submission was the same religion that set them free. This demonstrates the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just like the good Samaritan in the text, Jesus came by and saw our condition. Of America.
Amen.
Jesus sees beyond the surface.
Amen.
He has bandaged up the wounds inflicted upon us
yeah.
by physical and systemic racism.
Yeah.
He opens doors that we cannot see.
Amen.
Jesus can make it all right. The good Samaritan carried the man to a safe place, paid for him to stay there, taking care of his expenses and whatever else he needed. He put himself in danger to help someone that others had overlooked. He could have been overtaken, praise God, by thieves himself. Jesus put himself in danger, harm's way, that he would save the world. He was crucified for the sake of a sin-sick world. John 3:16 says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have eternal life. Praise God, he paid for our present and our future with his very own life. And as he died on the cross, his death took care of everything that we would ever need now and later in this world and in the next. I'm so glad that he rose on the third day. He rose so that we have power to be neighbors to one another. He rose with all power in his hand so that we would have the power to stand up for those who cannot stand up for themselves. He rose that we would have the wherewithal to speak and speak up, praise God, for those whose voices have been silenced. King did for social justice. For so long we thought we have hand, or afraid to extend the baton of mercy to make a difference in your town, your neighborhood, in your church? Is there a neighbor in the house? Is there a neighbor who will reach out to those who don't look like you, talk like you, think like you, see the world like you? Is there of neighbors of all races of people, all ethnicities, all cultures, all nations, black, white, red, yellow. Is there a neighbor in the house? Pastor Hezekiah Walker wrote these words, I need you and you need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me, agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It's His will that every need be supplied. You're important to me, and I need you to survive. Hallelujah. We can grab a hold of that concept. Hallelujah. It will help us to understand, hallelujah, that we have the power, we have the wherewithal, amen, to be like the Good Samaritan, to reach down, not look down on someone, but reach down and pick them up. Praise God, as a good neighbor, as a neighbor, to show mercy, to show kindness, amen, and to walk humbly before our God. Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. Is there a neighbor in the house? Praise God.
Amen.
Some of us have been asleep for a long time.
Come on.
But I'm so glad that God woke me up.
Yes.
We live in our little fish bowls of life.
Yeah.
We never go beyond our little safe spaces to see what's happening out there in the world. How others are hurting. How others who may not be like us, you know, don't have the advantages that we have.
Come on, preacher.
Or the advantages that you have.
Come on.
But I wanted Micah 6:8 read today because God has said something so profound in that text.
Yeah. Yeah.
That we will always want to come and bring God offerings.
Yeah. Come on.
Do our little churchified stuff before God.
Come on.
When all God cares about is how we treat one another.
We have not been to the mountaintop, amen. But we've been in place to receive power, to receive the word so that we can go out and let others know that there is someone named Jesus who is not only died, but he rose again that we might be empowered to be a good neighbor, to reach down and help somebody else up. Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. Let us hold hands across the sanctuary.
Amen. Amen.
Let's come across the aisle and let us connect together. as we sing this prayer of praise to the God we serve.